that why do living organisms use 4 nucleotide bases and 20 amino acids? These nucleotide bases and amino acids form the alphabet of the genetic languages. Actually, there are two languages. One is that of DNA, which is made up of these 4 letters, and another is a language of proteins, which is made up of 20 amino acids, and there is a translation machinery between the two as well. And I have been working on, well, off and on, in trying to understand these questions with little bit of mathematics, but lot of inputs from what can be just called common sense. And that's what I am trying to present to you today. So here is the abstract which is there in the book. Molecular biology is a nanotechnology that works. It has worked for billions of years and in an amazing variety of circumstances. At its core is a system for acquiring, processing and communicating information that is universal, from viruses and bacteria to human beings. Advances in genetics and experience in designing computers have taken us to a stage where we can understand the optimization principles at the root of this system, from the availability of the basic building blocks to the execution of tasks. The languages of DNA and proteins are argued to be the optimal solutions to the information processing tasks that they carry out. The analysis also suggests simpler predecessors to these languages and provides fascinating clues about their origin. Obviously, a comprehensive unraveling of the puzzle of life would have a lot to say about what we may design or convert ourselves into. So I start with a question made famous by Schrodinger: what is life itself? There is no unique or complete characterization of life, but even in the primary school textbooks now there are definitions. And the important feature which you have to always keep in mind, that it is a fundamentally a non-equilibrium process, and it's characterized in terms of two basic phenomena which go under the name of metabolism and reproduction. Metabolism basically are a set of biochemical processes needed to sustain a living organism. It requires a continuous supply of free energy from the environment. Reproduction is that despite all these processes, same structure can't survive forever because of all kind of disturbances and damages which environment will inflict on it. So life basically perpetuates itself by a succession of generations. So these are processes, and the question which has puzzled humans for thousands of years, that these phenomena are obviously sustaining, protecting, improving something, and that too is against the odds. What is it that is being sustained, protected and improved? And the answers range from philosophy to science, and I'm going to concentrate on science. So the fact is that something is being protected, but everything is made up of atoms, and atoms are fantastically indestructible themselves. They just get rearranged in different ways. And if you do a little back of envelope kind of calculation, quickly arrive at the answer that we would have a billion of atoms which belongs to the Buddha or Genghis Khan or Isaac Newton. And that's a sobering or a thrilling thought, depending on your attitude. So what are these atoms circling around or going rearranging themselves? Well, the rearrangement is the fact which is essentially providing some biochemical information. And living organisms evolve by altering these atomic arrangements, manipulating these informations. Molecules keep on changing in the process, and the atoms are shuffled. So this is the bottom line. Hardware is recycled, but the software is improved. And the question is, what is this software? And how is it connected to the hardware? What we know from information theory is you need complex structures to basically code information. So information here, I'm trying to take more in the context of knowledge rather than entropy. Because if you take a collection of atoms, it still has lots of entropy, and that doesn't serve the purpose. You must arrange them themselves and provide them with some interpretation. And once you add that interpretation to this, basically a random collection like entropy, you gain what is the knowledge, and this knowledge then can be communicated using a language, and every language must have an interpretation, otherwise it doesn't serve the purpose. So we have to construct a language. How do you design a language for carrying out a specific task? Well, there are certain optimization kind of guidelines that you don't want to waste too many resources. And under the resources, you can classify all kind of physical labels, space, time, energy, etc., etc. And on the other hand, you also want to implement the task in as error-free manner as possible. So a computer designer basically grapples with these two questions. At the level of software, it's a question of what is the task, what is the algorithm. And the hardware is, how are you going to connect this algorithm to actual physical operations? And the efficiency of the whole business depends on both software and hardware. You can't decouple the two. Though in practice, it's easier to look at individual questions first, find an answer, and then try to see how you can put them together. What are the ingredients? They form a kind of hierarchy of scales. At the bottom are atoms, not very many in numbers, mostly it is carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen. Sometimes phosphorus and sulfur play a role. And the small molecules involved in this languages, nucleotide and bases and amino acids have about 10 to 20 atoms. Bigger structures involving peptides and drugs about 40 to 100 atoms. Proteins have about 100 to 1000 amino acids. Genomes have from 1000 to a billion nucleotide base pairs. And sizes range from molecular nanometer scale to the size of a cell, which is a fundamental unit of a living organism. It's about 10 raised to 4 nanometers. And from here to here, there is a hierarchical machinery. Lots of information about this machinery has become available in genes and protein databases. So if you have some ideas, hypotheses, you can form models, you can test them, you can derive some consequences and see whether they indeed satisfy the hypothesis or not. And I will basically make a hypothesis of optimized information processing and then check how well it works. So we want to understand the reason for the specific languages and their specific realizations. And there is a little footnote that if there is life elsewhere in the universe, maybe these principles will have something to say about it. So here are simple biological facts. I have to state them, but this is a description which is not very deep in the language of biologists. They will quibble about things here and there, but I have to do the simplification because if I don't do the simplification, I don't get anywhere. So what are the facts? First thing is that these genes and proteins form a language which is universal. All the organisms use the same letters for DNA and the same letters for proteins, which says that despite all the variety of living creatures which we see around, somehow they have selected a very specific language. And this is the reason why bacteria can cause diseases to us. They speak the same language, though not the, our verbal language, but at the basic scale, and so they can hijack the machinery without too much trouble. Okay, it's a universal language. Next thing which the databases told us about, that the information is stored, but it is stored in a limit close to the data compression limit of our best computer algorithms. The packing is maximal. And so there is obviously a storage which has been optimized. How it has happened, we don't yet know, but this is a fact which you can just deduce by taking these databases and giving it to our base programs, compress the file, and they can't do it. And the third thing which is well known is, when talking about optimization, we already are familiar with a fundamental mechanism which leads to optimization, which is Darwin's theory, that there are random mutations in the genetic sequence. Only some of those mutations survive in a competitive environment, and the winners are, in some sense, optimizing the outcomes. In biological textbooks, people tried understanding these languages after the discovery of DNA and protein structures, and things didn't quite fall into the place according to the computers available then or the mathematical theories also available then. And they basically kind of started discussing biology in a scenario which goes under the name of frozen accident, which essentially says that we don't care where the language came from, it somehow came into existence and it's such a vital part of the machinery that any change in it will be highly deleterious to living organisms, or so we are not going to change it, we are just going to assume it as a starting point and derive all its consequences. Such a scenario is possible when the machinery which produces the language was an extremely rare event and no possibility to explore other options. That is not the viewpoint I am going to take. My viewpoint is going to be the optimal solution scenario where the language arrived at its best form by trial and error, not by an accident. And it did not change thereafter because any further change would make information processing worse. Of course, this scenario requires enough time to generate many possibilities, subsequent competition amongst them to select the best one, and that is the ingredient of Darwin's evolutionary theory. What are the criteria when one can go down in detail trying to characterize what is needed for optimization, local changes, getting stuck in local minima versus global optima, etc. But the essential point is that the critical control parameter in an optimization process is the time available for exploration against the number of possibilities and the transition time between them. So depending on how much exploration time you have, you will have to decide whether you can go from one possibility to the next or not. The basic processes are well known. Now, there is a process of change and there is a process of selection, and biological processes, this is labeled as a mutation, and this is essentially competition among different organisms. There are two names which go in the biological textbook, the process of change is described at the level which is called genotype, and the process of selection is described at the level of phenotype. And these two levels are actually quite distinct. One is at the molecular level, and this takes place at the level of the whole organism. And our genetic algorithms actually try to just put both of them at the same place, but in the real world it doesn't occur that way. What I am going to do is look at the simplest possible machinery where the gap between genotype and phenotype is not very large. And that can occur only when you can look at very primitive system which may be made up of unicellular organism, probably didn't have a nucleus, genomes were very small and not too many hierarchical levels between genotype and phenotype, and then the optimization criterion can be applied more easily. So now let me come to the crux of the problem. What is it that is being solved? So there are the tasks assigned to both DNA and to the proteins. Biologists have characterized these things in great detail. DNA, what does it do? It basically assembles a chain of building blocks on top of a pre-existing master template. And that's essentially all it does during the whole life cycle of living organisms, nothing else. What do proteins do? Is they convert the information sitting in DNA into three-dimensional structures, which are molecules of very different shapes and containing lot of different chemical groups. And the proteins carry out many functions in every cell based on what these groups are and where they are located. And the way it occurs is by very specific binding and short-range interactions. The fact that this short-range interaction is a consequence that the way molecules interact with each other is through van der Waals forces, and only if they are sufficiently close to each other, the forces will feel some effect, and so it essentially becomes a lock and key mechanism. Only when the complementary shapes fit very well, the interaction is high. If one part touches, other part doesn't touch, the interaction is small and nothing much happens. And so the job of the proteins is to define or design lots of different locks and keys in three dimensions. We have to keep in mind that the wrong key should not open the lock. So they have to be distinguishable from each other. So these are the same tasks, and they require two different languages. This is a one-dimensional language, this is a three-dimensional language. But to come to think of it, this kind of dichotomy exists in our computers also. There are two different languages. This is a language of memory. In this particular case, it's only a read-only memory, but in our computers, we have memory which are magnetic, typically on a hard disk. Or if you have a CD, well, some other kind of structure, but it's a language of memory. Its job is to sit there in a very stable environment for a long time, and magnets have that particular property. This is a language where things are happening, generally very fast. The execution of various tasks, and in the computers, this thing is done by electrical circuits. And they take something from here and put something there, and the gates do various things, bits flip here, there, etc. And at the end, you have a result which you go and put back into the memory at some stage. So this is a magnetic language, this is an electric language. It happens that in computers, both of them are binary. But they are different physical realizations of the binary language, and you need a translation machinery between them, and our laws of electromagnetism actually allow us to do that. Here the languages are little more complicated, and there is a little more complicated translation machinery also. When dealing with this task, what do you optimize? One thing which you want to do is minimize errors. No misidentification in this lock and key or reading or writing that will destroy the whole business, and this essentially forces a digital language. Continuous variables are actually no good from distinguishing one from the other, and that has obviously happened in the genetic machinery. Building blocks are distinguishable, the operations they perform are also discrete, and one can live with this because we know that all practical applications need only bounded error calculations. Other thing which you have to minimize is the amount of resources you have to invest in a particular task. Your problem has to be solved, but efficiently. And so you try to use small number of building blocks, small number of simple, quick operations. And that means that in a language, you have to emphasize versatility, which means the same building blocks can be joined together in as many different ways as possible to do lots of different things. And from this point of view, one arrives at importance of what can be called a minimal language. It's the language with the smallest set of building blocks for a given task, which can solve the problem. What are the advantages? Well, if you reduce the number of building blocks, the tolerance against errors goes up, because discrete variables will be spread over some range of hardware properties, but if the number is small, you will put them as far away from each other as possible. You also have a small instruction set. The number of possible transformations among these discrete variables will be limited. And just to illustrate this, I can give our own experience in dealing with a decimal system, where to do arithmetic in our primary schools, we had to all memorize 10 by 10 tables to do addition and multiplication. But if you go to a binary language, those tables become 2 by 2 and can be implemented in hardware by using only 2 gates. And so obviously, the binary language happens to be the smallest instruction set in the classical realization of any language. Other thing which minimal languages allow, and that actually is a major reason of why everything has turned Boolean, you have optimized all these criteria, largest tolerance, smallest instruction set, you can also achieve with these possibilities, high density of packing and quick operations, because you have to make everything as reliable as possible and also fast, and having a small number to play with definitely helps. And after doing that, you essentially land up with a simplest language for any possible job, and you have to not worry too much about translations. Simple physical responses can be mapped to the hardware. So these are the criteria, and I will just give a summary of the answers of what happens in case of proteins and DNA. What is the purpose of the language of amino acids? As I said, it's to form protein molecules of different shapes and sizes and containing different chemical groups. What do we find? Well, you need a language in three dimensions, and so you have to talk about geometry for designing three-dimensional structures. What is this geometry? Well, it's a simplicial geometry in any dimension. In three dimension, it forms tetrahedral structures and diamond lattice. But in any dimension D, the smallest discrete geometry is characterized by D plus 1 points. And if you look at protein structures, well, tetrahedral geometry and diamond lattice actually play a very important role. As a matter of fact, the various secondary structures which go under the name of alpha helix, beta bands and sheets, they fit very well on a diamond lattice. What are the best components to realize this tetrahedral geometry? Well, you go and look the whole periodic table, and there is one candidate which stands out, and that is carbon. You can also include nitrogen ion and water, which will fit into this tetrahedral geometry very well, but not much else. One can well point out that silicon is also there, it has a tetrahedral geometry, and actually it is far more abundant than carbon in nature, but it's not used in any of this biochemical machinery for the reason that the structures made up of silicon go into crystalline patterns. They form periodic structures, and in dealing with any language you have to keep in mind that non-periodic patterns are the most important feature of a language. If it becomes a crystal, it's like a stuck record, it doesn't carry information. You need non-periodic structures and the ability to manipulate them, and carbon is the best candidate, and of course that is what sits at the bottom of the whole machinery of life. I can also add that carbon also does efficient job on two-dimension patterns as well in the language of graphite sheets, which is again a simplicial structures but now restricted to two dimensions. Suppose you decided on this geometry, how you are going to build structures? Well, you have to put two things together in three dimensions, but it's not necessarily a easy job to arrange it when you don't have a luxury of an external designer or a sculptor or architect which says that okay, you have got the right shape and now stop. The simpler solution, which has been part of even our computer systems, is that you make one-dimensional chains, and inside that one-dimensional chains put instructions about how to fold into three-dimensional structures, and you can see that in the screen. Okay, this is a, what you are looking at is a two-dimensional picture, but how is it stored in the computer disk? Well, it has a lots of dots going from here, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. It goes to the end and it says turn around. Next line. It's a one-dimensional chain folded up nicely, so when you look at the whole thing, you see a two-dimensional pattern. And so you can do for three-dimensional as well. If you do that, the pattern can emerge, you can design all kind of three-dimensional structures, but now problem is simplified, that now you have to only organize one-dimensional chain, and the instructions for the folds are part of the chain. And so here is the what happens in case of proteins. The basic ingredients are these structures called amino acids. They are the smallest molecules which have one end of the carbon attached to a base and the other end attached to an acid. And that property gives a very simple way to create polymers. You keep on joining base to acid, and you can stretch it as far as you want. And the carbon has a tetrahedral property, so there are two other things which are hanging out. In case of proteins or amino acids, one of them is always a hydrogen. But the other end is kind of flexible. It has been labeled by this R groups or residues or whatever other names, and these differ from one amino acid to other. When you say there are 20 amino acids, they have 20 different molecules of this type with different values for the R. And so when you form a chain, this basic backbone is from base to acid, etc. This repeats, keeps on going. But this R groups keep on hanging out on the side. They are not part of the backbone. And they basically dictate what this protein is going to do. In particular, they will decide how this chain is going to fold in a three-dimensional space. You put different R groups, they have different chemical properties, they will decide whether I would like to bind with this thing or whether I will like to stay away from this side, and so on and so forth. And so we have to understand the folding of the chain, we have to necessarily understand what the properties of these R groups are. So now you again do a little exercise, first in mathematics and then go back into biological information, that if you select a tetrahedral geometry and you have select a chain, and now you want to fold the chain, not on a square lattice like what is there on the screen, but on a diamond lattice, you have to decide so many orientations at every step. Okay, how many orientations are there? Well, you can easily count. There are 9. The reason for them is that this is a tetrahedral structure, and if you look at the bond from a carbon to any other one, it's a bond with a rotational symmetry of 120 degrees. You take a tetrahedron, you rotate by 120 degrees, you will come back to the same shape. So when you try to arrange these things, you land up with these rotations of 120 degrees, and there is a famous plot named after Ramachandran which shows how these various locations occur in the case of protein molecules. The shaded areas inside here are the ones which occur in natural proteins, putting in all the details about what all atoms are involved in various locations, and so some regions are ruled out because there is a steric conflict. You can't put one atom on top of each other, and other regions are allowed, and the shaded areas basically describe the allowed regions. And the stars are the points which will be allowed if the geometry was exactly that of a diamond lattice. Okay. So you can see that there is a very good overlap between the stars and the various allowed regions. Even these are little islands possible here and there, and in diamond lattice can produce a sufficiently good job of covering the allowed angles, and one can actually do more to look at not just these angles but bigger structures. And as I said, alpha helices and beta sheets basically provide some of these important points. This point refers to alpha helix, beta sheets lies in somewhere over this region, and so on and so forth. So it has a good overlap. And so now the task of these R groups can be labeled, that they have to favor one of these 9 orientations in creating these folded chains, and also they have to fill up various cavities in the structure, because as I said, this is a non-periodic structure, it's not a crystal. Just try to crumple up something by folding, you will immediately realize that there will be lots of holes left over here and there. And if the structure has to become stable, and I already said that its natural occurrences show that the structures are maximally packed, all the cavities have to be disappeared, and that job also has to be given to these R groups. And so what can we say now? Well, we said we have to pick 9 orientations, but we have 20 amino acids. These numbers don't look very close, but I will give a list of 20 amino acids. If you have not seen them, don't worry too much about it. But there are all kind of names and symbols for every one of them. They can be classified according to this properties of the various R groups. They are, well, chemical labels. Molecules can be polar, non-polar. They can have charge, positive, negative. They can also have ring structures or aliphatic, which are straight chains, so on and so forth. And there are, all the 20 can be described. And this essentially is the whole list which you can make by properties of organic molecules. What is extra and which I will have to return at the end is that there is a pattern inside this 20, and that has been labeled by this classes. There are two classes of amino acids, and the pattern is such that in every property half of them are in class 2 and other half is in class 1. Not only that, it's always the lightest of the lot which is in class 2 and the heavier one in class 1. And this molecular weight is in some sense measure of the size of the R group in real three-dimensional volumes. So, is this the solution to the problem? Well, it is not. It is only the beginning. And what do you have to do for the solution? Well, a lot more, and I certainly don't have the answers. But what you have found is a description of the basic letters of the alphabet. Now, if you want to use or construct a language, you have to make words. You have to create grammars and sentences and things like that, which means studying how all these things are going to interact with each other and in what possible ways. And lots of people all over the world are trying their best to understand it. There is no complete answer, and no complete answer is possible in a immediate future, but we are looking for some clues. And these are little bit of out of box thinking, because all the, you can take the database and grind it into the computer, and all known algorithms, they are not helping very much. You do lots of things, and so here is the clue. Now, this may look like a completely garbled thing, but even if you are not familiar with crosswords, surprise yourself by reading it. You aren't going to believe that you can actually understand what I am writing. Because of the phenomenal power of the human mind, according to a research at Cambridge University, it doesn't matter in what order the letters in a word are. The only important thing is that the first and the last letter be in the right place. The rest can be in a total mess, and you can still read it without a problem. This is because the human mind does not read every letter by itself, but the word as a whole. Amazing, huh? Yeah, and you always thought spelling was important. So that's the clue. In biology, you always remember, if you find a good solution, you will use it over and over again. History repeats itself. And this is the problem with understanding proteins. The wide variety. And this language is certainly not a one-dimensional thing. It's in three dimensions. But the letters themselves don't matter that much. What matters are the active sites and endpoints of secondary structures. In between, you can fill in lots of different things. They have substitution tables for various amino acids. You take out this and put something else, and it still works the same way. So the understanding now means that, well, you have to understand what are the important endpoints and how you are going to place it in three dimensions. And I just wanted to present this as a something which you can remember from this talk. Okay, I don't have the answer of the three-dimensional problems, but certainly this is a little out-of-the-box thinking which can help. Now let me go back to the second problem. What does DNA do? Well, as I said, the proteins was a problem in three dimensions which got simplified to making one-dimensional chain. and you still have to make that one dimensional chain, and DNA does that. But it can't do it on its own, it has to rely on a master template. And after that, it does basically copying, which is literally an assembling of a molecules by picking up components from an unsorted database. Everything is randomly bouncing around to find the correct nucleotide base and stick it in this place, find the next one, stick it over here, over and over again. And well, how one can describe it is a game played in school, basically doing an unsorted database search, find the name of a person, two teams, one writes the names, gives it to the teacher, the other has to guess it by saying yes or no, asking questions, etc. And we quickly learn how to play it. You don't ask very detailed questions, you ask very simple binary yes or no questions and quickly narrow down the option to one of the persons, and the solution is described in a computer language as a binary tree. You are basically trying to mimic that. That doesn't work in all situations, and Love Grover discovered a different algorithm which is better than binary tree search. And what is this algorithm? Well, it does unsorted database search, and Love found it in the context of quantum dynamics. But as it turns out, it can be implemented in a more general context where you are dealing with waves. You don't really need to go down all the way to quantum mechanics. You can perform a database search process using coupled waves. And in the algorithm, well, you need several steps. And it starts with a set of distinguishable objects, which are kind of randomly floating around. In the case of biochemistry, there are DNA, RNA, amino acids, they're all there in the cell in some way or the other. And I should say that there is a selection feature built inside it, because even though you find the same amino acids and nucleotide bases in DNA and proteins, in the cells there are many of the other type. There are other nucleotide bases floating around. There are other amino acids also floating around, but they are never used in the languages, and which is actually a very important clue that there is a selection and optimization buried in the whole language. The assembly process is actually linear, and at each step there are molecular bonds which are essentially labeled as base pairings, essentially a complementarity rule which tells which is the correct block to attach and which is the wrong one. And you keep on doing this process, yes, no, essentially by this complementary matching, and build the whole chain. And Love's algorithm predicts various numbers of how many objects you can distinguish by asking a certain number of questions. And this is a formula which comes out of rotation of the state vector in two-dimensional space. But the numbers are indeed the ones which are important, which says by asking one binary question, you can distinguish 4 objects. By asking 2, you can distinguish 10. By asking 3 questions, you can distinguish 20. And this is the puzzling part as far as the biology is concerned, because these numbers are there at the bottom of these genetic languages. DNA replication involves one base pairing, distinguishing 4 different bases. And protein or the amino acid chain synthesis requires 3 base pairings, distinguishing between 20 objects. So the question is why these numbers are there, and what is this middle one? Does it have any meaning also, or well, what if you can go further down in the chain? So before going into that business, let me just contrast it again with the classical one. The classical answers are very different from those ones, where with n items you will end up with log 2 n binary questions, or if it's unsorted, it's order n, and quantum answers are completely different. They basically work with wave mechanics, and the difference between here and here is in one side you deal with amplitudes, the other side you deal with probabilities. And that is the essential difference between the two, where if you are working with amplitude, you can do superposition, you can have interference, etc. kind of things, where probabilities are all positive and they can only add. Nothing more complicated you can do, like subtraction or cancellation, which can occur in the wave dynamics. So here is a simple illustration of Love's algorithm in the case of four items. You start with an initial situation where all amplitudes are equal. It's called uniform superposition. Then there comes a binary question, the oracle, which flips sign of one of the amplitudes. And afterwards, you just allow the system to relax. And in any wave dynamic situations, when you relax the system, it tries to go back in the initial state, in which case it's a uniform average over the whole state. And so when you start here and allow it to relax, it will oscillate about this mean position, and you look at what happens to the system after half an oscillation period, which means this is the mean, you just reverse the sign of everything relative to the average. And this picture, if you do that, you will end up with all the amplitude in one object, everything else becomes zero. And so you have to stop the algorithm at this particular process if you want to perform selection. All amplitude comes here and nothing over there, that is the operation which is projection. Okay. So now for little fun, I described a system based on these coupled oscillators. Last year in my talk at IIT Kanpur, and it was such a simple thing that I gave it to my son to make a high school science project. So here is a system of four oscillators. Some weights are hanging and these things are going up and down. They're coupled in very specific manner, which means that the masses and the spring constants are tuned in a particular way. And let's see what happens. This is the initial state, uniform superposition. Then one of them is elastically reflected. The velocity is reversed in sign. And as you can see, the one which is reflected starts bouncing with a lot more energy than all the others. Play it once more. Here comes the reflection. It picks up the energy. There's the amplitude amplification. And you can see very clearly that yes, it bounces much more than the rest. And of course, the algorithm is complete if you stop it at the right point, when there will be an instant where the movement in one of them is the maximum, the other ones are moving slow. If you stop there, that's the selection procedure. So there is nothing complicated in the algorithm. Wave dynamics can do it. You don't need quantum mechanics per se. And so, well, important question is such a thing possible in the genetic machinery? There are bonds, molecular bonds. They can have lots of vibrations, rotations, etc., which are essentially simple harmonic motions. Are they coupled in the right way? to execute the necessary conditions for the algorithm. Well, in principle, there are lots of ingredients which are capable of doing the right job. What we need is a test which will confirm whether this is indeed the case or not. But at this stage, I can make this statement that if you have to design a system to implement this particular task, knowing all the physical laws that we do, we would opt for something like what is present in nature, the solution of Love's algorithm. It's to be contrasted with a classical picture where you will have a binary language, which means only two nucleotide bases. It's enough to code the information and it would be a simpler system from chemical point of view. So the question naturally arises that why did nature complicate itself? It could have started with two letters and did not have proceeded further to the language of four letters unless there was something to gain. And as we know, the advantage of Love's algorithm that it does the job faster. Was this the real incentive for nature to complicate the system? This is just what happens in case of base pairings. And the questions are this: what did nature do? Was the algorithm exploited? Can't really answer it because you can't repeat evolution of life. But what is possible is there are some remnants of this algorithm even today inside living cells. You can perform some experimental tests. So that's as much as I would like to say about it. I don't have experimental tests to confirm or deny this particular algorithm right now. But something else which I mentioned earlier, and that happens to be something else that I looked for and found some answers, and it was a surprise because biologists hadn't noticed these things earlier. And that is the question of how is an amino acid recognized by the genetic machinery, and it is recognized by this complicated molecules called transfer RNA. And the transfer RNA has amino acid at one end and the anticodon at the other end. These two things certainly can't talk to each other, are too far off. But the way this recognition works is this transfer RNA is somewhere in the middle. Amino acid is in some sort sandwiched between this and these big molecules called synthetases. And I earlier mentioned that there were two classes and they are labeled by whether the synthetase sandwiches this amino acid between tRNA and itself from one left side or the right side. The molecules are chiral and so these two things are distinct. And class 1 will attach from this side, class 2 attach from the other side. And what I found surprisingly, that this classes, okay, labeling has a connection with the genetic code. There was no reason for this particular connection, but it's something which is worth exploring. I will not go into too many details, but the numbers are important because, as I said, there were 9 folds on the protein chain and the two classes have 10 elements each. So that is a number close enough. And what this machinery says that there is a duplication process sitting under the whole machinery. And the process, well, it can be described in all these genetic code tables. You have to take some biochemical information to simplify this, which is possible in terms of what are known as wobble rules, and some recent data which showed that there is some jugglery among these things if you study ancient organisms, and which produced a table which looks like this. And there is a pattern here which cannot be missed. It's a clear duplication in this particular column. The third letter doesn't matter. In this column, the third letter doesn't matter. In other one, in one case, the third letter doesn't matter. In the other case, the first letter doesn't matter. So there is a simpler code which relies not on three bases, but only on two. And the present table is a merger of these two different codes, one on one first two letters and the other on the last two letters. And this doublet code in Grover's algorithm required two queries and distinguishing between 10 alphabets. And this is a recent result which came out of biochemical data analysis involving all the transfer RNA and amino acid synthetases. And that basically said that the present form of 20 amino acid language arose by duplication from a more primitive language with 10 amino acids. And that is certainly a very useful information, and one can push further, want to go further back in time. What was the even simpler language? Maybe the answer is 4, if I believe Grover's algorithm was still executing at that particular level. And this is a very important question for people interested in how life originated. It's right now too far from me to give any answers. So what do we need? Well, there are all these mathematical features and data in biological databases. We want to construct an atomic scale model to implement Grover's algorithm and mapping these languages one versus the other. And that's an open challenge. Anybody who would like to pursue it, well, I throw it open to them. I'm certainly working on it. And you don't need huge amount of background knowledge in any subject, either computer science or biology, to be able to work on these questions. Probably when you're idling with getting bored with everything else, it's fun to ponder these questions. And here is a list of various papers which I have wrote on this particular topic. Thank you.
One of the questions I'm asked when every time I mention your work is that, what about coherence? How could this algorithm be implemented incoherently?
Yeah.
Does that spring thing answer that question?
In some sense, yes. If you use the algorithm in terms of vibrational modes and not in terms of quantum waves, the stability is much better. You don't have to worry about coherence questions anymore.
Yeah, that spring idea does not need any coherence, right?
It has some amount of damping, but the damping is much smaller.